Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Fireside Chat, this the 3854th edition thereof. We are, of course, engaging in the age-old wilderness tradition of sitting around the fire and telling tall stories, and, of course, on my left, no greater tall storyteller in the world, or taller storyteller in the world than Brent Leo Smith. Hello, Brent.
Hello. Hello, James. Hello, everyone.
Brent, what have you achieved this afternoon while we have been slaving away, risking our lives?
I managed to watch half of the first set of the Wimbledon men's final.
The Wimbledon men's final.
Yes.
And not going according to plan, of course, because nobody I was supporting is in the final, in fact. So who cares who wins? Now, we have got some interesting things to show you today. Mostly, we've got cubs, an overload of cuteness, where Brent and I embarrass ourselves, as you will see shortly. Then we're going to have a look at some leopards, and then some elephants. But let's go straight in with the overload of cuteness, the lion cubs of the Nkuhumas.
Hello, everybody. On our live safari, I would like to introduce you to three identical little lion cubs and their mom, our new members of the Nkuhuma Pride. They've been hiding out on Torchwood. We've been patiently waiting for them to appear. And there you go, the first proper sighting of the Nkuhuma cubs after months and months of the sort of chaos in the lion dynamics and watching the tragedies of the Nkuhuma Pride unfold. To see these three little faces staring across at us, well, it just doesn't get better than this, does it, Brian?
Nope.
And I'm so glad that we could share this moment with all of you. The smallest obstacles seem pretty large when you're only 5 weeks old. How spotted they still are. Whoops! I'm sorry, I'm doing that thing I do when I see young cubs where I forget how to talk and I just giggle incoherently.
Not sure what happened there, everybody, but here we are, and to my starboard side, Jamie,
Hi.
The lion hunting, cubbing, finding person thing. Would you like to go through your emotions when you first saw those cubs and try not to giggle like Brent and I did?
It's a struggle. There's just something about that moment that renders us all completely incoherent. And it's not just me, but all three of us did it.
In fact,
we really genuinely couldn't contain ourselves in that excitement. And I think it's the emotional investment that we've had in this pride, watching the from start to finish, in a way, this chapter of their lives, to see them in that moment was incredible.
And Brent, you seem to indicate today that you thought the debate was finally completed over what was cuter.
Oh yes, no, it's the delectable little monsters.
It is, the delectable monsters. Yes. I never thought I'd hear that come out of Brent Leo Smith's mouth. I'm sure Jamie didn't either.
No, that
comes as a
shock.
I'm sure she's probably hoping not to again. But we've always been banging on about the fact that I've said it a few times, that I thought lion cubs were, if possible, even cuter than leopard cubs. And I'm sure you can see what we mean there. Of course, I now feel utterly disrespectful to George and Charlotte. You can see Brent recoiling visibly as I said those names. Ha 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 ha. And I thank you all for using them so liberally in
Stop
his presence.
Now,
thank you
please.
Very much.
It is going to be mass confusion.
We are going to name those leopard, those lion cubs as well, aren't we?
We are?
Yes. We are. They're going to be called Kirsten, Jerry and Louise.
Well, I was going to go with Lion 1, 2 and 3 myself.
Yeah, no, but Kirsten, Jerry and Louise are much better. And because Jerry is a kind of generic name, could be Gerald or Geraldine. If there's a male, then he will be...
All three of them are going to turn out to be males.
Boys, so that will be the best.
Anyway, we'll see what happens there. No doubt there'll be much conflict. Okay, so that was the lion cubs, the cuteness overload, those spotty little delectable wonders, as Brent sort of puts it. Let's go across now to an even better sighting, I think, just not from a cuteness point of view, but from an interest point of view. Two male leopards establishing themselves in the world. Have a look at this.
This is more than a nice surprise. This is behavior you don't see often. Now that is quarantine. And if you listen really carefully, you can hear a low growl. Now that is quarantine, and about 40 meters away is Tingana. And they're growling at each other. I'm not sure that's Tingana. And I'm just gonna have it. I think this could be Shivambalan. I've never seen this leopard before. There he comes. Oh, now this is gonna be interesting. Now, this is gonna be very interesting. How is quarantine gonna react? Is he gonna stand up to the challenge, or is he going to skedaddle? Look at that. Oh, Mr. Q is taking his cue. But he's trying not to move too fast. He's like, I'm not actually moving away from you. I just felt like getting up.
So that was really, really fascinating. And it's not often you see males of that age compete like that. I've seen lots of older males, sort of 8, 9 years old in those sort of tussles. I just couldn't believe the sort of audacity of quarantine. I mean, to completely ignore a physically much larger leopard from that close distance.
Now, I mean, the question on everyone's lips, and I'm going to pass it over to Jamie because I don't know the answer, is do they have some kind of kin recognition, or is it completely, could they be strangers?
What's the age difference between quarantine and Kunyumas? 2 years?
3 years.
No,
two and a half years.
Shivambalana
and quarantine.
Two and a half years,
yes, I think there might be. Especially given the, well, I'll tell you why I say that, because of the level that the males don't gain independence straight away. So they often leave and come back to their mothers. Mm-hmm. And I think that they probably, Shivambalana probably would have encountered quarantine and Kunyuma at a young age, just moving back towards mom. Brent's going to disagree. I don't know. I don't really know the answer. That's just my feeling.
I'll tell you why Brent's going to disagree once he's disagreed. Okay, go for it.
No, I think you should go first.
No,
otherwise you're going to claim to be right either way.
No, I'm not. I have no idea. What do you think?
I don't know. There was some fresh scarring on their faces. Mm-hmm. And I think that had been going on a lot longer than we were there. And
so you think they had physical contact?
I think so. There was a fresh cut under Shivambalan's eye that was from that day, and quarantine also had some relatively fresh scars, which I only saw afterwards when we looked at the clips and when I looked back at the footage. And I don't know, that Shivambalan was reasonably upset, but quarantine's is a big 4-year-old male leopard. So I don't know.
I don't know either. I often like to think that there is this kind of emotional attachment, as many of you do, but it's great to have the old cynic here because it keeps us all in balance. Otherwise, we'd be convinced that they were about to have a tea party together. Anyway, wonderful sighting, fascinating, and it'll be great to see what happens going forward from there. And also, I mean, Shivambalan could well be taking Imvula's territory, most likely, in fact. Okay, we're going to move on to a really quite violent PG moment with the elephants that Jamie had this morning. Have a look here.
For me, as much as I love our big cats and our graceful leopards, our magnificent lions, those of you who have always wondered about the vocalizations of other elephants and have heard those sorts of sounds before, and we've often spoken about the shame, the one's actually a bit concerned. It's all right, Benjamin. It'll be fine.
Well, I didn't have that particular interaction, but we did see young Benjamin this morning, and at least this afternoon. Wonderful sighting that Brian and I had. Looks like he's had those hair plugs put into the top of his head, don't you think?
He's the most amazing-looking baby elephant I think I've ever seen.
And amazing not in terms of his good looks.
No. I wouldn't describe him as a good... He's very cute.
Yes.
But Benjamin Button, I think, describes him perfectly. It is a very well-chosen name by Aqua. What we did want to talk about, sorry.
Dogs barking. Very odd. Don't know what's going on.
That wasn't what I was expecting, but neither was that attack by the female elephant. It took me completely by surprise. My thoughts, I was on my way to answering a question about whether or not elephants are sentient, at which point she then turned around and pinned the young bull to the ground, which I said, initially I thought it was a cow just because it happened so fast, but looking back, it is a bull. And I have no idea... what provoked it, because it wasn't on top of her or the baby. The baby was on the other side of her. I mean, think it happens a lot.
For me, there are two questions there. For me, the first question is there some kind of discussion going on between them, whether we're not aware of? And even Cynic here is nodding, so it must be true. And secondly, were they related? Why did that youngster then follow the bashed up bull again? Why did he follow him? What do you think?
Maybe you wanted him to get another hiding.
Blaming him.
Yes. I don't know. It's very interesting. And I think, I mean, we hear those type of sounds all night and all over the place. And I've seen often female elephants hit those young bulls, but I've never, I think that where the road was and just he happened to trip, maybe that's why she got on top of him. But I definitely think there was communication we can't hear. I mean, they have so many low rumbles that are far beyond what we can hear. Yeah.
Maybe he cheeked her.
How old do
you think? He was cheeky.
Quite possibly. Yeah.
Really, I think she might. Maybe she told him, and this is actually a theory that one of the viewers put forward, maybe she told him to go away, and he didn't.
Yeah. How old do you think he was? How old do you think that bull was? Pajamas?
I'm sorry. derailed. Adam. Maybe 8 or 9.
8 or 9. So, yeah. I mean, he's not about to leave the herd.
No. Not anywhere near that.
Okay.
Yeah. No, he was quite young still.
Marvellous.
It was incredible. Really fascinating.
Yeah, really good to see. And like Brent says, we hear that stuff all the time. I'm going to attempt to play a song now that doesn't sound like that.
Fortunately.
It's a song that's not related to Africa at all. It's not related to anything we do here, really. It's just a really good song.
My favourite, I think, of all three of us.
Yes. And so I'm going to play it. And, of course, I first heard it played on a 12-string guitar. It is, of course, by the great David Gilmour. And his, some would say equally great colleague, Roger Waters. I would say slightly less great. But here we go. This is a song called Wish You Were Here. And we will see you tomorrow during the course of the dawn safari at 06:30, when hopefully this vile cloud would have moved off to make way for another beautiful, clear winter's sky. So until then, goodbye. I've been led to believe that you don't. Yes. So you think you can tell? Get you to trade your heroes for ghosts, hot ashes for dreams, whatever a cool breeze, a cold comfort for change.